I started graduate school in 2005 to do basic neuroscience research in a learning and memory lab and a basic neurotrauma lab in animal models. In 2008, I went to Burning Man, and I actually saw a series of lectures by MAPS talking about all the different psychedelic research that was happening in the United States at like UCLA and Johns Hopkins, and I was just floored. I couldn't believe that this was actually something that was happening in the scientific arena, and it was potentially something that I could be involved in as somebody working towards a PhD in the neurosciences. I first went down to Peru in 2010 to take ayahuasca for PTSD. When I was in graduate school, like I said, I did basic research, which means you basically do animal research, whatever your disorder is, and my disorder was spinal cord injury. And I felt very shameful and traumatized about having to work with animals. I really didn't like it. I didn't see what the relevance was for humans. When you're stuck in the lab, it's hard to see kind of the bigger picture perspective of why you're doing what you're doing. And every animal I had to work with was just absolutely terrifying for me. I always kind of personalized it a little too much and would sort of feel like, what if I was the test subject? Would I want somebody doing this to me? So I had a lot of ethical issues and moral issues around what I was doing. And by the time I finished my PhD in 2010, I actually wanted to leave science. I didn't want to have anything to do with science anymore. I was really kind of just sick of the whole thing, and I didn't like the way that it was done. A friend of mine told me about this center that had just opened up in Peru that was offering to send people down to Peru to take ayahuasca if they couldn't afford it, if they really needed the healing. And so I submitted a video testimonial outlining my situation and why I wanted to take ayahuasca. Luckily, I won one of these trips, and so I was like an all-expenses-paid trip, thankfully, to go down to this center. It was 10 days in Peru. And I won't go into the details of my own personal journey. I did find some catharsis and healing from the shame and trauma that I felt about doing animal research. But what really impacted me when I was down there was I just happened to serendipitously be there doing ceremony with a bunch of veterans that had PTSD. And when I first got to the facility, I was actually admittedly kind of afraid of these men. They were just these big guys that seemed to be, you know, they had a lot of problems, and I was a little nervous being around them, but kind of watching them soften up and watching them heal and seeing that transformation that they went through because of taking ayahuasca really motivated me to get back into the research field, come back into science. I went back to the United States and was like, how am I going to research this in my career? And so I wasn't a clinician. I wasn't a psychologist. I had no idea about any of the science of ayahuasca. I ended up taking a job at UCSF in 2011, sort of working in my same field, spinal cord injury, but actually, just as an aside, working on collecting data from other people that have already finished their studies so we can create these huge animal repositories that we can use to answer our questions rather than answering them in animals. And so I've been really excited about doing that, and it, you know, keeps me funded and it keeps me employed, but it's not actually what I want to do in the long term. I want to study ayahuasca for PTSD, obviously. So one of the first things I did when I got that position is I reached out to Rick Doblin at MAPS. And I just sent him an email and I said, I just got back from Peru. I took ayahuasca. I see how effective it might be for PTSD. How can I get involved in this research? What do I need to do? And he was like, well, you know, we don't actually have anything going right now looking at ayahuasca research, particularly for PTSD. Our focus is MDMA. However, it's funny that you contact me right now because maybe a week before that, he had been contacted by National Geographic, and they were looking for somebody to follow down to Peru to monitor some people with PTSD that wanted to take ayahuasca. It was for this TV series called Drug Think, and it was a series, the specific episode was focused on hallucinogens and the therapeutic potential that they had. And so I felt very fortunate to be able to be part of that. And so I went down to Peru. They sort of like had me listed as the expert in this documentary, which I thought was kind of funny because I was, you know, just had my PhD awarded to me and I had no real experience in this field other than a desire. Through our conversations, I wanted to get my name out there of, like, you know, proposing this idea of ayahuasca for PTSD. So I actually asked Rick if I could submit an article for their bulletin that they put out a couple times a year, just sort of proposing the rationale of why I think ayahuasca would be useful for PTSD. And he let me submit an article, and that was really great. And I submitted it with a colleague of mine, Julie Meckner, who's a psychiatric nurse practitioner, because I don't have any psychology training officially. And then from that, I was asked to speak at Psychedelic Science in 2013 about a similar topic. For those of you who don't really know a lot of the details about what PTSD is, it's essentially a maladaptive coping to a triggering event, a traumatic event. It's normal to have strong reactions to life-threatening situations. Normal adults have a decrease in these reactions when the threat is no longer present. PTSD patients, however, have a persistent reaction even when the threat is gone, and they develop unhealthy coping mechanisms that exacerbate psychopathology. So there's lots of different ways that PTSD can manifest. It's very complex. There's a lot of different things that can influence how someone's going to react to a traumatic event. There's a lot of things that will predict how somebody responds, and so there's all these pre-traumatic risk factors that are very well documented in the literature that influence what's going to happen after this traumatic event happens. And these could be things like socioeconomic status, genetics, medical history, comorbid conditions like depression or other psychiatric disorders, gender, age, etc. Normal people will have resiliency to this trauma. They'll fulfill an initial threat, an initial sort of disturbance, but then they'll have normal adaptation and they'll recover and they won't develop PTSD. Some people will develop PTSD, but then they'll have some responsive to treatment, and this has really helped when they have good social support systems in place. Persistent PTSD happens when someone develops maladaptive coping mechanisms such as addiction or isolation or withdrawal from their social circles. So that will lead to the persistence of the symptoms. And then there's this sort of fairly new idea called complex PTSD, which happens when somebody is in an ongoing traumatizing situation. So, for example, like if you have an abusive spouse or you live in a war-torn region or if you're in a violent urban area, it's really hard to manage someone's PTSD when they're continually being re-traumatized. This is the physiology of how the brain responds to different stresses and how PTSD gets out of control. And so in normal control, this is sort of the limbic system and how it's activating the HPA axis, which is involved in our adrenaline fight or flight response. And so normally, you know, something happens in the amygdala, in the hippocampus, that you think of something that's a little scary. It activates the amygdala, which activates the HPA axis, which in turn will flood your system with adrenaline. And that's your fight or flight response. And normally when that happens, that surge of adrenaline will cause inhibition of some of these upper regions in the brain that will then shut that system off so that you no longer feel triggered. In PTSD, however, there's sort of a dysregulation of this where you'll have these psychogenic stressors, which could be triggering memory or thought or fear, or you can have a physiological trigger, just some imminent physical threat in your environment. It causes a hyperactivation of this HPA axis where it's unable to sort of auto-regulate itself and shut down that adrenaline response, and so you get this like constant influx of this circuitry that's sort of keeps sending the stress signal to the limbic system. And actually in PTSD patients, it's become so severe that you see things like hippocampal atrophy, where the hippocampus actually will shrink, and this can cause substantial cognitive deficits in patients with PTSD. Some of the effective treatments for PTSD so far, other than MDMA, are SSRIs. They act to reduce that amygdala response that will activate the HPA axis. And there's also cognitive behavioral therapy, which is really useful because it helps them recontextualize the way they think about their trauma. And another interesting therapy that is out there that is effective but can be somewhat dangerous is exposure therapy. So you basically expose the patient to what was their traumatic event, and sort of try and have them re-experience that, but do it in a safe setting so that they can deactivate that circuitry that's causing this like hyperarousal all the time, and hopefully return that system to baseline where then they can have these sort of triggering memories, but then they won't cause this physiological adrenaline fight or flight response. The hypothesis here regarding ayahuasca is that ayahuasca sort of mimics SSRIs pharmacologically, and that it also experientially kind of mimics exposure therapy. And the reason why I think ayahuasca might be useful but potentially dangerous for PTSD is that exposure therapy in someone with really severe PTSD could actually be re-traumatizing, so it really needs to be set up in a really safe and supportive way so that the experience itself isn't re-traumatizing for the person. There is quite a bit of published literature on the therapeutic applications or indications that ayahuasca might have for various conditions. One of the first studies that came out was from Charlie Grove in the 90s, looking at ayahuasca and able to treat alcohol addiction. They saw people have decreased alcohol use following ayahuasca, and they had a control group in that study. More recently, it's been shown to have some efficacy in drug addiction, caveat being it was a small pilot observational study, so only 12 participants in the study, but they did show significant effects of decreased substance use, as well as qualitative measures of psychological and behavioral function that were also improved. There's some evidence that it might be beneficial for cancer, but there hasn't been actually any studies on this. This is sort of a meta-analysis that I found in the literature about ayahuasca being used for people that have cancer, and there's just been these sort of positive case studies that have come out of that that were reviewed in this paper in 2013. And then there was a couple studies that came out in the last 2 years looking at ayahuasca for depression. And so those are studies coming out of Brazil, where there were two small open-label studies. The first was in 6 patients, and the second was in 17 patients, and they saw significant reductions in some of these common measures that are used to assess depression, which is showing a lot of promise, and this is important for PTSD because depression is oftentimes comorbid with PTSD. I was able to speak at Psychedelic Science in 2013, and I didn't really have any data other than the rationale for why I thought ayahuasca would be useful for PTSD. But what I did have was some of the veterans that I happened to be doing ceremony with in Peru shared with me their trip reports, basically the experiences that they had and how they interpreted their healing process after taking ayahuasca. Taking all of the text from their experience reports and putting them in the word frequency cloud, the main thing that popped up was the fact that they kept referring to it as medicine. Talking to them individually, they had decreased aggression, they felt their symptoms were gone, and a lot of that has maintained to this day. We keep in contact and they still seem pretty stable and healthy to this day, which is sort of a testament to me continuing to do this work and seeing how their recovery has continued. Arrowhead is this really great resource of experience reports and all kinds of information about various drugs. Each of them are categorized based on different things, such as whether it was a difficult experience or a mystical experience or if they had some kind of health problems. There's not a whole lot of people saying that they had bad trips, but they do claim that it's difficult. Difficult doesn't always necessarily mean that it's a bad experience or that it's just challenging, but a lot of really hard work can be difficult and challenging. But they're also rating it just as high as being mystical and these glowing experiences with very little problems. And so just looking at a general PubMed search, it's just a comparison of all the different Schedule 1 drugs of abuse that are being researched and reported on in the scientific literature. Obviously, ayahuasca is kind of a minority here, but if you cross that with whether they're therapeutic studies, larger proportion of these studies are focusing on the therapeutic benefit of ayahuasca, so a lot of the science that's coming out is very predominantly focused on what the therapeutic applications of this powerful medicine is. Because ayahuasca is gaining a lot of notoriety lately in the press, people are either claiming that it's the best medicine they've ever had, or they're claiming that it's causing horrible things like psychosis. There's been a couple deaths associated with it. It's not clear whether people are dying from ayahuasca or rather some complications about the setting. So I think it's really important that we sort of get at what are the risks and benefits of taking ayahuasca? What are the appropriate settings? And how do people with PTSD respond to this medicine? I was able to get MAPS to fund this online anonymous survey. I was inspired by all the different surveys that are happening, looking at mystical experiences and various types of drug use. And I thought this would be sort of a low-hanging fruit because there's not a whole lot of information about what ayahuasca can do for PTSD. So I have the survey out. I launched it in June. Obviously, this is a survey. It's not a prospective study. It's not a cross-sectional study. It's retrospective. So I'm having people answer very detailed questions about what their ayahuasca experience was like and how that related to them either getting better or worse from their PTSD symptoms. And obviously I couldn't control for, you know, there was no inclusion-exclusion criteria other than have you taken ayahuasca, do you have a diagnosis of PTSD? So there's obviously going to be a lot of variability in the set and setting for the population, but it's a good useful tool just for us to kind of get a sense of what might be going on in this population when they take ayahuasca. This is a flow chart of how I included the data that I'm going to show you. This number is actually a little low because I get more responses every week, and so as of today, I actually have 370 responses. Not everybody completes the survey, and part of my IRB consent is that the person has to complete the survey to the end in order for them to have consent for their data to be used. About half of the people are completing the survey, and of that, I have an additional question at the end asking, now that you've taken the survey, do you still want to contribute your data to this study? And most people say they're fine with it, but a few people did decide to drop out, so I don't include those people in the data. These are just some of the data patterns and the measures that I've been using. The y-axis here is just the percent of participants and what their response rates are. Most people answer the information about demographics, age, religious preferences, whether they served in the military. And then there's details about their ayahuasca experience. Where did they take it? What was the context? What was the preparation and support that you had? What was the experience like? And then what were some of the possible dangers and helpful things that you experienced? And then I have an assessment of what changes they remember having in their PTSD symptoms, if they had any, as well as any changes in drug use immediately after ayahuasca, as well as any treatments they were on before they went to take ayahuasca and how that changed once they were done taking ayahuasca. in my home. What were their intervention techniques, social support, and then various psychometric scales to look at sort of psychosocial function, including a growth inventory that measures resiliency, a PTSD checklist, which is a self-report measure of PTSD symptom severity, a depression measure, as well as sleep quality. We really want to boost how many participants we have to maybe 500 as of now. Completed responses is actually 170. Some basic demographics from this. We have a good gender balance by two assessments of PTSD in this. One was, have you ever been diagnosed with PTSD by a clinician? And then most of the participants were civilians, and most of the participants were white. It seems the predominant facilities are those that are in South America, because it is legal in Brazil and Peru. And then also, it seems that most people, in terms of integration types of therapy, are doing meditation or yoga, and some people doing individual therapy and some other forms of therapy that were sort of these open-ended questions that I'm still getting at what those other individual forms of integration are. Again, this is very preliminary, but we are seeing some fairly consistent patterns. The top graph is what was their substance use changes 1 week to 1 month after taking ayahuasca. Mostly people are reporting that they have decreased alcohol use, decreased prescription use. There is some increased psychedelic use, which is kind of interesting. I wonder if that's part of some people's integration process. Regarding their symptom changes, white is an improvement. And it looks like across the board so far, we are seeing a trend of improvements in some of these symptoms, both 1 week and 1 month after taking ayahuasca. With the caveat that these are people that are just trying to remember back to that time frame after they took ayahuasca, whether it was a week ago, whether it was 3 months ago, whether it was 10 years ago. But generally across the board, we're seeing most people saying that they have a decrease in most of these symptoms, which is promising. But I had two different measures of PTSD. One was just, have you ever been diagnosed with PTSD by a clinician? But then I also had a PTSD checklist. I was curious if potentially people would think they had PTSD, or maybe they didn't, or they had never been diagnosed because maybe they didn't have access to somebody who diagnosed them with PTSD or didn't want to be diagnosed with PTSD, so they just never actually got assessed. For the people that don't have PTSD reported never being diagnosed with PTSD, about 20% actually did test positive when I scored it according to sort of the standard guidelines of how you would actually diagnose somebody using this measure. For people that claim to have a current diagnosis of PTSD, actually some of them were no longer showing symptomatic evidence that they would be testing positive to have PTSD, according to this. And then there was sort of like a mixture of half and half for those that said they were in remission, but then some were still testing positive as having PTSD. And so now I've kind of grouped these responses based on those two criteria. So one of the questions I had nested in there was, what aspects of the ayahuasca experience did you find either dangerous or helpful, both during and after the experience? Regarding who thinks there's some dangerous aspects of the ayahuasca experience, there does seem to be a higher trend in the people that had a positive diagnosis of PTSD, and I still want to look into what the exact descriptions of what those things might be, and that sort of maintains some of the aftercare that they have or have not received. Taking some of this information out, these were a lot of open-ended responses. The quickest way for me right now, just to kind of get a general sense of what's happening, is to do these word frequency clouds. And the general sense I got is that people felt that if they weren't with somebody that was experienced or knew what they were doing, they felt that that was really dangerous. They also thought it was dangerous if they didn't have somebody to help them walk to the bathroom, for example, or just, you know, having that person there to monitor them and make sure they had the right amount of support. There was also a lot of people that didn't like the fact that they were in a room with other people, and they felt a little triggered by other people's processes of purging and whatnot, so that seemed to be pretty triggering for some people. Regarding what they found to be helpful during the ayahuasca experience, it seemed that most people liked to know that they had an experienced shaman. The music was sort of a key aspect of this, just really having that safe, supportive environment with somebody that was very knowledgeable and all of the different comforts and things that accompany having being able to go deep and feel safe and supported. Regarding things that people thought were dangerous afterwards were things like not having enough time to recover, being sent home, having to drive, and not having anybody to talk to afterwards, whereas the things that they thought were helpful were obviously having community support, having a group of people to talk to, having professionals that they could integrate with, and this was a very prominent theme and what people found to be really helpful in order to process their ayahuasca experience. And so looking towards the future, we're actually trying to plan a clinical trial in the United States to look at ayahuasca for PTSD. This isn't an easy task. Obviously, we need to get all the DEA and FDA approvals, but I'm in the process of writing a protocol that I'm adapting from the MDMA for PTSD clinical trial protocol. We're going to have two or three experimental sessions where we administer ayahuasca, and then immediately after that, we'll have some integration sessions with each patient, and then we'll do 3 months of integration after the final ayahuasca ceremony, talking to some psychotherapists that sort of do integration work, they recommend that having weekly integration for at least 3 months after some of these really intense experiences is really beneficial. I really want to publish the results of this survey just to kind of get the information out there so there's more that we can cite about this. The first paper I'm hoping to write up with some consultation from Via Labate is going to be more of like an anthropological descriptive paper about some of these responses that people have in the different settings. And then hopefully if we can get at least 500 total participants completing the survey, I'd like to do a more quantitative paper that we submit to one of these like higher impact scientific journals where we can run stats and hopefully make some conclusions that we can draw from and use as rationale to convince all these different regulatory agencies that we can actually do a clinical trial on this. I just want to thank all you guys for coming. I want to thank Horizons for inviting me. Obviously, I want to thank MAPS and then our ayahuasca working group. We basically have calls every month to discuss the development of ayahuasca for PTSD clinical trial protocol, and I'll take any questions. We want to adopt a model of using the constituents that have been used in some of these therapeutic models, like the ones they're using for the depression studies in Brazil. We're still trying to determine whether we want to use a liquid form or the freeze-dried form. They have different pharmacokinetics and experiences. So right now we're leaning towards a tea, a standardized tea, that we can test using, you know, like HPLC and things like that. But we're trying to determine whether we want to import it from Brazil, from the people that have already done those studies in depression, or whether we want to find someplace locally that, you know, has a DEA Schedule 1 manufacturer's license that we can get it from and that the FDA and the DEA can approve, because we really need to find that source, open up a drug master file, and then get an IND and all that stuff. You want to have the appropriate medical equipment in the next room should they have some kind of physical cardiovascular complications. But I would like to set up the room to be kind of indigenous and to, like, keep the traditional context. This is something we're actively discussing. It's a bit back and forth. Some people think we should have just a straight clinical setting. Some people think we should really preserve the traditions. It seems from the responses from the survey, people like to have, like, the Icaros specifically, they like that music. They like having a sense of connection with sort of the traditions of the plant. I know personally when I took it, I actually was able to take it in the jungle, and I felt a deep connection to the plants. You know, I just felt like I was part of this network, and I don't know if that is also experienced when people do it in, you know, a living room in the United States or what, but I'm leaning towards more ceremonial, traditional type of setting, but with sort of Western precautions in place. Because PTSD patients need a lot of monitoring and care, and because we're getting a lot of reports of people saying they don't like having other people around them, I think we want to do one-on-one sessions, you know, having a co-therapy team and just one patient at a time. Right now, probably not. Probably looking at the combination of the admixtures, although it would be, ideally if we had enough money and we can get approval for a sufficient number of patient enrollment, it would be nice to sort of have different combinations to see what's actually the therapeutic component. But for an initial study, you got to keep your sample sizes fairly small, so I think we want to stick just with the traditional combination. And then maybe when we phase up, there might be options to do sort of like side studies about that. But there is some evidence in the animal literature about this, especially with harmine. I think somebody talked about this yesterday, showing that, you know, it can be effective for preventing edema and traumatic brain injury in animal models. So yeah, it'd be interesting to look at. Especially for someone with PTSD, if it's bringing up a lot of triggers and it's sort of re-exposing them to their trauma, I mean, because like I said, it's kind of like exposure therapy experientially. And so when that's the case, you really need to have support. You need to let them make sure they can process that so it doesn't just become another traumatic experience. And so I didn't show this, but there was one participant who didn't have any history of PTSD, but her experience, because she didn't have any support afterwards, she actually felt that that was one of the most traumatic experiences of her life. So I really think it's important to have that so that they can process and really make it something useful in their life. If somebody had like complex PTSD, really severe PTSD, ayahuasca may not be appropriate for them because it's kind of like exposure therapy, and in that instance, it can be re-traumatizing, so MDMA might be more appropriate. And I don't know that you would want to pre-treat with MDMA and the new ayahuasca, but I would say for now, we would want to have people that have less severe PTSD taking ayahuasca and more severe PTSD taking